Good morning. How are y'all? How do you, you guys have been amazing. Let me just say thank you, first off, because you came in last week and we turned your world upside down, did we not? Kind of inside out, yeah, and you guys are amazing. And I said last week to make sure that you know who to blame. If you like it, it was my idea. If you hated it, it was David's. I'm just kidding. It was my idea. And the purpose, just so you understand the purpose, especially through this 21-day fast, but really I say that, but you know, that's who we are as a church. It's about being a family and understanding that we're not on this pilgrimage, this walk, this journey on our own, but there's other people that are engaged in the same walk that we are. And sometimes you feel like you're all by yourself, and this is kind of a weird way, maybe, of putting us all in a position where it's almost like we're more like a family. That's kind of just my weird way of thinking, I guess. And you get to see each other. I don't know if that's good or not. You're trying to figure that out, aren't you? Yeah, you can kind of see each other and engage a little bit more so that you know that we're on this journey together. And I just think that's huge. Because God never intended for us to do this thing called the Christian life in isolation and alone. Now, we have Him, and that's great. And for Him to be present with us, I mean, all, that is so, so sweet. But let me tell you what else. It's also very cool to understand that we can do life together with other people and do it in community. And that when we struggle together, and we pray for each other, and we lift each other up. And so that's just kind of the heart behind doing this kind of thing. And I thank you for being so patient and so for letting us do that. We'll get back to, you know, the stage thing. We'll get back to that maybe next week or so. We'll get back. I know we couldn't do this every week, but I do think just based on what, you know, you guys have said, we'll probably do this again because it seems like it's worked really, really well. Also, we didn't plan this either, but we're going to baptize again. You're wondering what this is out here for. We're going to baptize again. Had a really, really sweet conversation with a mom and one of her daughters after the second service, I think. Yes, after the second service last week. I'm old. I can't remember what I did this morning, so much less try to remember something from last week. And it was a sweet, sweet situation. This little girl, she said, you know, when are you going to baptize again? And I said, well, I don't really know. I'm the pastor here, but I don't know a lot. But you know, we can probably go online and find out. And I said, why are you asking? She said, she wanted to be baptized. And she had me, pretty much. She had me. And I said, well, I think we can just do it again next week if you want to do that. So anyway, it's a cool, sweet family. And four daughters, a mom and four daughters, a single mom and four daughters. And so out of the four daughters, we're going to baptize three of them in the next service. So is that cool or what? It is very, very cool. And so I'm just probably like what's going to happen is you probably already, maybe you're not a follower of Jesus, and maybe through the service today, something's going to happen. And you're already feeling that thing kind of going on inside. And that's just God. Don't sweat it. And so God's just kind of showing up and He's speaking to you, and it's really, really sweet. And so you may find yourself after the service saying, well, I'm ready. Well, we're ready for you. We've got a change of clothes. We got jeans from the Buckle. We got really cool shirts. That's a lie. But we do have some great shorts from Target, I think. Target, the Buckle. I mean, that's kind of, you know. But we'll have a great time together. And so if you want to do that, honestly, you'll just meet me right back over here after this service. And I'd be thrilled to be able to baptize you today as well. You may have been a follower of Jesus for a while now, but you haven't followed through with baptism. And I would just say, like, why not? Why would you not do that? And we talk to adults sometimes and go, well, you know, I've gotten older. And so what? I mean, you're scared of water? Scaredy cat? I mean, you know, I mean, is that your deal? And so sometimes it's not really that you're afraid of water. It's that you just feel like maybe as an adult. But if you attend Springwell, then, you know, we baptize probably, I don't know, more adults here than we do children as far as a yearly average kind of thing. I think we just baptized 54 last year. It was an off year for us. Yeah, 54 ain't bad, you know. It's not bad. And so, maybe, you haven't followed through, and maybe today you need to do that. And you think you don't have to even go home. Like I said, we got some cool Target shorts and some T-shirts, and we got some towels. I mean, you really got no excuse. You know, we're ready. We're ready for you. And so I hope that maybe you'll follow through with that today. So we're in this series called Less is More, and we're in a 21-day fast. Get it? Less is more. And so a couple of weeks ago, we decided as a church that we're going to totally give up eating food and only drinking water for 21 days. If you're visiting for the first time, you're thinking, I'm not coming back until that's over with. Maybe. So in case you're new, or at least you're new to Springwell, or maybe, you know what, you've been a follower of Jesus for a very long time, but honestly, you've never, ever fasted before. And maybe it's not because you didn't think that it was maybe in the Bible, but you just thought that maybe it was a practice for, you know, those folks to do a couple thousand years ago. Or most of the time, I think, when people think about fasting today, they usually think in terms of fasting more for physical reasons than they do spiritual reasons. And actually, if you really go back and dig, when it comes to the whole idea of fasting, it was a way to bring everything kind of into balance. And so that was really the idea of the food part of the fast. So let me do a little bit of explaining. So for those of you that might be totally lost, let me help you understand what fasting is. Simply put, it's giving up something for the sake of a spiritual purpose. It's giving something up for the sake of a spiritual purpose. And our spiritual purpose is to give something up so that we can use that time to focus on Jesus. That's all it is. It's just that simple. And so, for example, we've talked about this every week, but you know what? Maybe you'd give up lunch, and maybe it would just be lunch. I know other people, one of our elders I talked to, and he's like fasting, you know, from sun up till sundown. That's his thing. And I said, and he kind of looked at me like, don't you want to do that? And I said, no, why would I want to do that? But the idea is that you spend time with God. And so maybe that would be a lunch hour, and that would be really important for you, that maybe give up that lunch hour and then maybe to hang out in your car or to find a place at work that you could kind of be by yourself. And maybe you'd bring out that little booklet that we provided for you, and you would work through that, and you would just spend some time praying. Or maybe it would be at night, you know, that you would give up a little bit of time, maybe watching TV at night and just spending a little bit more time with Jesus. So really, you know, less would be more. So we're actually praying for ourselves. Dan and Dylan talked about that just a few minutes ago, and it sounds a little selfish. It sounds like it's kind of that it's all about me mentality, but hopefully we explained that last week, and if we didn't, if you don't know what that means or you weren't here last week, then go back and watch that podcast. Maybe we'll help you to understand what fasting and praying for yourself really is. But here's the thing. And I think this is the thing that I have to try to work through, is when we talk about fasting, when we talk about giving something up, we focus on the sacrifice, I think. I'm giving up a meal. I'm giving up eating. I'm giving up TV at night. I'm giving up. But honestly, when you break it down and you understand that I may be giving this up, but I'm going to spend more time with Jesus. And listen, this is where I don't want you to be religious. Springwell has no earth. We have no intention whatsoever to just bring people to a place where you're just regular in church every week. If you're just regular in church every week and you feel better about yourself, then we're missing something. It's not just about being at church every week. It's about inviting you into a personal relationship with Jesus. That is the whole idea. And honestly, when you think about it from that perspective, spending more time with Him, and that God would actually want you to spend time with Him, then it's really not that much of a sacrifice. It's really not. And maybe when you start off, you think it's going to be a sacrifice, and you think, I'm going to give up, and this is going to be terrible. But you know, I know for me, and here's what I think. Every single time we go through this 21-day, and for Karen and I, most of the time, that's TV at night that we give up. And every single time when I do this, as I'm working my way through the fast, I always think, you know what, I should do this more. Like, there should be a part of every night or so many nights a week that I should just do this, because really I don't even miss TV at all, because I get an opportunity to hang out with Jesus, and that's what He wants you to do. In fact, if you were here last week, we talked about this picture of Him wanting to be with us out of Revelation 3. It's a phenomenal verse. Here's what it says. It says, Jesus speaking, he says, here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. And that is the most phenomenal verse, I think, in the Bible, that the God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, I'm talking about God. Are you with me? I mean, like in the biggest, broadest sense of God, how big and powerful and awesome he is. And that that God is standing on the outside of our heart's door and he's gently knocking, and his desire is to be with us. It is to realize that the reason that we were created and put on planet Earth was not so that we could do things for God. And I was somehow kind of raised with that mentality that really the reason that God created us is so that we could do stuff for him, that we would be his little servants. And really, when you just think about the flaws in that thinking, like if God could create everything that is and he could do that in 6 days and rest on the seventh, then really what does he need us for? I mean, really? He doesn't need us. He wants us. And that's the thing that will radically change your life. If you can come to the understanding, the realization that the God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, desires to be in a personal relationship with you. You. And you say, but you don't know me. It doesn't matter. He wants to be in a relationship with you. And so, all-powerful God, all-powerful God says that in spite of all my power and all my ability, there's one thing that I cannot make you do. Now, there's some things I could make you do. I could scare the snot out of you. And hello, can he not? I mean, I don't know if you've ever been there. I grew up in church, and the preacher, I think, you know, cause I do this sometimes because I look out and I see some of y'all nodding off. And so I go, ah! And yeah, I still got a little bit of the devil in me. You know what I mean? And so, you know, I'm always afraid somebody will cuss at Springwell, you know, say the wrong thing if I scare them. Anyway, I better move on. My wife's looking at me like that, so I'm going to move on. God could scare us and make us serve him. But the one thing that he cannot do is make us love him. And that's the thing that he desires the most. So we have this picture of God, this all-powerful God, standing outside a door, gently knocking, because he wants to come in and spend time with us. It's phenomenal. So I know there's a sacrifice in fasting, but, you know, giving up an hour of TV or 2 hours of TV or 3 hours of TV, really, it's not that big a deal. It's not a sacrifice at all. And every single time for me, and I hope that some of you are coming to that place as well, when as you're working through this fast, that maybe what you're thinking is, you know what, then this is really not that big a deal, and maybe I should make this happen on a more regular basis, and maybe I don't have to necessarily fast from, like, you know, from sun up till sundown, but maybe there's maybe one day a week, maybe one day a month, maybe I could just give him an hour every day because I would just love to be with him. It's not that big a deal. So we're praying for ourselves, and the second part of this prayer fasting challenge is to pray for others. I love this verse out of Colossians 1. So we have not stopped praying for you since we first heard about you. We ask God to give you complete knowledge of his will, complete knowledge of his will, and to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding. So how cool would it be? And I don't know where you are, because I was raised in church, and there were people. I remember I was in church one time. I didn't go a whole lot, but I went one Sunday. I went to this church, and this guy, the service was over with. He turned around, and he looked at me, and he said, Scott, I want you to know that I'm praying for you. And I said, well, that sounds good. I probably need the prayers, and you probably need the practice, so that's probably a good idea. So I've had people to tell me that over the years, and I almost do it in a condescending way. Any of you had people look at you and say that? There should be a few people at Springwell, like, I'm praying for you, bless your heart. That's not what I'm talking about. How cool would it be for you to be able to look at the people that you love? And what if you looked at them and said, I want you to know that a part of this 21 days, what I've been doing is I've been giving up time every single day and I've been praying for you. And listen, no, I'm not saying that I'm praying that, you know, you finally straighten your sorry, you know, no count life up. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that I just want you to experience Jesus the way that I have. If you could experience his love the way that I've experienced his love, I mean, if you could just like go beyond religion and church and all of that, but no kidding, if you would like just like spend a little bit of time hanging out with God and just experience God, and that's what I've been praying for you, that you just experience Jesus. How cool would that be? How life-changing would it be? Now, I'm not saying that this whole idea of praying for others is a new idea. It's not a new idea at Springwell. I mean, we got a prayer team, and you know, you probably have your own prayer list of people that you pray for. I know that I do. But I do think that the depth of love for others that drives us to pray with passion and heart, I don't think that's so common. And it really, really bugs me because I think that most Christians, I still think that we could change the world if we would learn how to love each other. I don't think it's hard. I don't think it's complicated. I think that the greatest evangelistic tool that the church has is not cool music. It's not lights. It's not sound. I think that the most effective piece of communication that we have is love. It's just loving each other. But I think we struggle with that. And honestly, when you think about real community and what real community looks like, what it's supposed to be like, I don't think that we understand that either. And so my go-to passage is Philippians 2. It's incredible. Philippians 2, therefore, if there's any encouragement from being united with Christ and any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having this very same love, being in one spirit and in one mind. And then he says this, do nothing out of selfish ambitions. And selfish ambitions, those were two words. And you know who that these two words were used to describe most often in this context? Politicians. And ain't nothing changed, has it? Selfish ambitions. And here's what it referred to. It referred to a group of people that really had their own agenda. That they were more concerned about accomplishing what they wanted to accomplish and could care less of who it might hurt or offend. Or what it might cost somebody else. And so Paul is saying, don't make it all about you. Make it about others. And then he says this. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Vain conceit is where I think I deserve something more than you do. So I've got a large fry, and I love fries. Anybody else, I love French fries, have mercy. I just love potatoes. Y'all love potatoes? I love mashed potatoes, fried potatoes, any way you can, you know, just slice them up, put them in a pan. If they're fried, they're better. We all know that, right? If it ain't smothered and covered, I mean, and you're in the South, and it ain't fried, smothered, and covered, I mean, you just aren't living life. And so anyway, just say I'm getting hungry just thinking about it, but I got a big old order of fries. Vain conceit is where I would probably just never look and think, you know what, I could share some of my fries with you. I would never consider that. I'd look at you, and I'd think, bless your heart. Don't you wish you had some fries? But I wouldn't think about sharing some of you. Vain conceit would never, ever consider that maybe I could at least give you a couple of my fries. I would never consider that. Vain conceit would certainly never consider that I should give you the fries. Never in a million years. And so Paul is saying, don't allow your self-centered pursuits fueled by the illusion that you deserve something more than someone else to control your actions. And then he says, rather in humility, value others above yourself. Here's the interesting thing. This is one of the reasons I love this passage as much as I do. It's because the Greek writers, writing in Koine, common Greek, when they get to this concept, they don't have any words. I mean, they've got nothing, not in this culture. And so they had to, honestly, they just had to make something up. Because they would never think this way. And so the thought basically is this: as you look around at the millions and billions of people that have come before you, as you look around at the billions of people that are on planet Earth right now, as you look even to the future at the billions and billions of billions of people that will probably come into the future, when you do that, you will probably come to the realization that you are only a speck on the timeline of humanity. I mean, you are a speck. And so when you do that, you will look around at other people and you will value those people more than you value yourself. And you aren't nearly as important as you think you are. And believe it or not, the world would still spin without you. Some of you, that's going to be a shock. And as you realize who you really are, as you look around and you consider all of the people that have come before, all of the people that are in your generation now, and all those people that will yet to come, you see other people as more important than yourself. And then he says this: not looking to your own interest, but each to the interest of others. Actually, the word interest, according to these really smart Greek people, it's not even in the text at all. It's not there. It's more of a concept to think through than it is a word. And so Paul is saying you're not supposed to spend your schedule. You're not supposed to spend your schedule. You're not supposed to spend your time. You're not supposed to spend all of your money on you. Could you imagine if you had friends like that? I mean, would you love, like, if you knew that there were people that really existed in the world and that everything that they had, they said, you know what? Everything I've got is not mine. Whatever I've got is yours. You'd love to hang around with those people, especially if they had a lot of stuff. You know what I'm talking about? Now, I've got a Harley, and I'm not buying into this passage of Scripture at all. That's what I'm saying. So don't come wanting to borrow it. I'm just... Paul is saying that the reason that you've been blessed, the reason that God trusted you with this stuff is so that you would be a blessing to somebody else. That's why you've been blessed with time, with money, with possessions. Wow. And then he says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be used to his own advantage. And I liked another translation better. I should have used it here, because it says, who did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped or held on to. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And so here's what Paul does. It's like he's working through these thoughts, the interest. There's not a word. I don't know how to really convey this idea. Vain conceit, you get that. But then there's a humility, and I don't really know how to adequately communicate that. And so it's like Paul says, you know what? There's not even words in the Greek language that can describe the depth of community and the care and the love that you should have for others. He said, but you know what? If you don't get anything that I said, then let me tell you what you should do. Just look at Jesus. And so if you ever get confused and you don't really understand community, you don't know what that looks like, and you're in church and you're hanging out with other people, and maybe those people aren't really getting it, if you know what, if everybody else that you know doesn't get it and you're confused about this idea of community, then just look at Jesus, who thought that you were more important to him than his being God. Did you just grasp what I just said? That we are more important to God. We are more valuable to God than God hanging on to his godness. That he let that go and said, I will go to earth and I will be willing to become one of them Because all I ever wanted to do was to be close to them and to be in a relationship with them. And there's a sin problem. And so because of the sin problem, something had to be done, and I'm willing to fix it. I mean, if that right there don't set you free, I don't know what else will. I got the easiest job in the world. He says, so you know what? If you don't really know what real love and concern looks like, because I know as fallible humans we get it wrong, then just look at the life and the actions of Jesus. And so my hope for us as a church, that's interesting. My hope, this is a great time to cast vision. Golly, bum, when we started this church, it was so different back then. It was different back in those days. It wasn't about cool church. We didn't understand cool church. You know, the only reason we wore jeans, not because it was cool, because I finally got sick and tired of looking at people and inviting them to church and saying, listen, just come as you are. And then they would come as they were, and everybody else would be dressed up, and they would feel like they were the odd man out. And I said, I'm sick of that. And listen, we'll wear our jeans, and because God didn't care about what kind of clothes we wear and whether we have on a three-piece suit or whether we have on blue jeans or tennis shoes or shorts. And all. And people get freaked out about people wearing hats in church, and I go, my gosh, have you forgot why we gather? I mean, we've gotten so political, and when we started, that was our heart. And then things changed, and it became about all this other stuff. And then it became about being cool and doing lights and sound. And that wasn't why we started this church. Could you imagine what it would be like if a church, and I think that we are doing so well, of grasping the concept of what it means to just reach out and love people. Just love them with no strings attached. That's why we do Christmas. In the 25 days of Christmas. Why can't we just give money away? And there's so many of those folks that want to walk along beside from time to time and to say, how do you know that every person that you buy their groceries, or you, how do you know that's a need? Maybe they're rich. And I go, who cares, really? At the end of the day, that I can say, wow, we're doing this because, we've just been over here praying, and God just, said, why don't you go buy their groceries? And it's not really about whether you have money or not. It's just that today what you hear is there's a God. He's huge, he's big, and he loves you, and he just wanted to bless you today. Wow, that's a novel thought, isn't it? Why can't we just, can you imagine a church like that? That's our goal. That's what we're shooting for. I believe that the greatest evangelistic tool that the church has is not great preaching or great music or great programs. I still believe that it's love. Then let me show you a passage of what happens. Acts 13, when we start to pray for each other. And this Acts church, man, they were stupid. These people were crazy. Oh, my gosh. They sold their stuff. They said, man, we got some people that's got needs. And somebody said, man, I got a car. Yeah, I'll sell that sucker. And, okay. They sold what they had. Maybe it was a camel. I don't know. But they sold their possessions, and they gave to each other, and they loved each other. And what was happening in that church was so contagious. And people just said, I don't know what you people have got, but I want it. And they just loved on each other. And this is an example of that love. And among the prophets and teachers of the church at Antioch of Syria were Barnabas, Simeon, called the black man, Lucius from Cyrene, Manion, the childhood companion of King Herod, Antipas. This is where we get the Antipasto salad. I think that every single time. I am so sorry. That's not true, by the way. Somebody go home and say, I didn't know. I'm sorry. God loves me. Anyway, and saw one day as these men were worshiping the Lord and fasting. They were worshiping the Lord and they were fasting. And the Holy Spirit said, dedicate Barnabas and Saul for the special work to which I've called them. So after more fasting and prayer, the men laid their hands on them and they sent them on their way. And this thing happened in that church. Before this, there had been no missionary journeys. There had been no movement to Asia Minor. There had been no movement to Spain. But suddenly, these men felt this call of God. They were fasting, they were praying. And then after they fasted and prayed, they said, well, listen, just go send these guys. And if that hadn't happened, there wouldn't even be Acts, because that was a book. How much of Acts would not be there, because so much of that describes the missionary journeys of Paul. 13 books of the New Testament wouldn't even be there, because all of those were a result of the missionary journeys that Paul went on. And so many of these letters was him writing back to a church to encourage them. We wouldn't even have so much of the New Testament if it weren't for the fact that these folks fasted and prayed and they loved on each other. And out of that fasting and praying and loving on each other, that these guys just felt this tremendous call. And where did this whole missionary movement come from? Was it a branding thing? Was it some kind of church growth strategy? And I don't know. It wasn't. And so when I read this, and maybe I'm reading too much into it, maybe I'm doing a little bit more eisegesis than I am exegesis, but when I look at this passage, it reminded me of the way it was for me when I finally got a hold of the Jesus thing and come to the understanding that God loved me. And I'd never had a class in evangelism. I had no earthly idea, you know, that somebody's blood might be on my hands based on Ezekiel. I didn't know all that stuff, and so I didn't know. All I knew was that I had found that God loved me and that he really loved me and that he shed his blood for me and that he wanted to be in a relationship with me. And then listen, I found the relationship part. I mean, that he and I connected in prayer and I would meet with some guys and we were stupid, man. We didn't know. We didn't have any kind of boundaries really. And so we'd holler and yell and scream and pray. I don't know why we did. Just what we did. And we didn't know that might be labeled Pentecostal by some or freaky by others. We just didn't know. It was just out of the excitement that was birthed out of a relationship with Jesus. And I just wanted to tell everybody that I knew. I had found something. And you know who I wanted to tell? I wanted to tell all my friends. I remember the place that I worked. I mean, I worked this place and I was pretty rough when I worked there. And I remember going back and seeing Sandra. She might remember some of those days, but don't tell anybody if you, I'd appreciate it. And I was kind of rough, but I went back and I was a different person and they thought I was the same old person. And so they would try to, you know, were we going to go party? And I'd say, no, my life's been changed. A guy laughed at me one day and I said, it's been a short period of time since I gave my life to Jesus. You better hush or I'm fit to knock you in the floor, you know, because God will forgive me when it's over with. I'm just saying. I hemmed a guy up in the bathroom one time. I said, don't you want to give your life to Jesus? He said, we're in the bathroom. You can pray right here, right now, and accept Jesus as your Savior. It's crazy. But I had found something, and I think that's what happened here. It wasn't some kind of, we want to create this. They found something, and they just wanted to tell everybody. They wanted them to know. So, who are you praying for? And what exactly are you praying for them? I know you got friends that are probably struggling financially, and you should be praying for them, absolutely. And you got maybe friends and family that are sick, and they're seeing some, hearing hard words from a doctor, and you need to be praying for them, absolutely. But let me tell you what will get those people through all of those difficult times. It honestly will be a relationship with Jesus. That will be what gets them through. I know that. I know what it's like to be on the verge of thinking you're going to lose everything that you've ever worked for your whole life. I know what it's like to be in that moment and then to realize that you can answer this question, is Jesus enough? And the answer be, he is. He's enough. If God never blesses me with anything else, and if it was just me and him for the rest of my life, is he enough? Yes. And is that what you're praying for your friends, that they will just experience Jesus? If you're new and maybe you can sign up, we've got another 7 or 8 days. I guess it depends on how you look at it. And we'd love to just encourage you to be a part of just praying with us for the next few days to finish out this week. Maybe you're not a follower of Jesus, and the reason that you're not is, you know what, you just had some really bad information. You had no idea about the love of God, and not just the love of God for the world, but you had no idea about the love of God for you. And this morning, some things have just maybe begun to make sense, and you felt something in this place today, and it's certainly not me, and it's certainly not music, and it's not a band. It's the incredible presence of the Holy Spirit of God that's right here in this place right now, and that he's speaking to you. And see, Revelation 3, he's standing at your heart's door, and he's just knocking. The God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, he's standing right now at your heart's door, and he's knocking. And he says, you know what? I'm awesome. I'm God. And there's nothing that I cannot do, with the exception, I cannot make you love me. But if you will give me the opportunity, I will step into your life. And I will love you. And I will never leave you nor forsake you. You never, ever have to worry about me packing my bags and leaving. I will be there to stay. So every head is bowed and every eye is closed. No one's looking around. If you're here this morning and you're not a follower of Jesus and you'd like to be, then maybe you would just pray a prayer or something like this. Just quietly, silently, right there in your seat. Maybe you would just say, you know what, God? I mean, I get it. And suddenly, this makes sense to me. I get it. And I don't know why you would love me the way you do, but I know, I've just come to the understanding this morning that you do. And I'm telling you that I believe in you. Thank you for your love for me. So I'm asking you to forgive me of my sin. I'm telling you that I believe. I can't explain it all, but I believe in Jesus, and that you're the Son of God, and that you went to the cross. On the cross, you died to pay the penalty for my sin. I believe that. And I believe that on the third day, you were raised from the dead. You're alive. I can feel your presence with me right now. So I'm asking you to forgive me of my sin, and I am, to the best of my ability, surrendering my life to you. Thank you for your love. Everybody look this way. Last week, we closed the service a little bit different, and we're going to do the same thing today. And I love this song. Oh, this song is... listen to it every day, that much more. But the words just, man, so speak to my heart, and I hope that they'll speak to yours as well. So I'm just going to ask if you'll stand with me, and the band is just going to lead us. And my encouragement to you is that you'll just worship. And if you don't even know what that is, just don't sweat it. Just hang out and just enjoy the presence Jesus.